since we'll talk about our, this is reminiscence, this is how we got into folk music, how we, what we, you know, what our experience was. And so I'm going to begin, and I'm just going to talk for a few minutes about my own experience as a member of what later became, what we later understood to be called the urban folk music revival. And I grew up in Salt Lake City. I lived in the house on 2nd Avenue, and our family moved there in the early 50s, and they're still there. My mom is still there. And when we were, when I was growing up, we had Burl Ives records in our house, and all my cousins sang them. We sang them at traveling and when we went to the canyon and all this kind of thing. So Burl Ives songs were just part of our life. And we also sang rounds, and we also sang heart songs. We sang other kinds of things as well, Drink to the Me Only with Thine Eyes. And we just sang all kinds of songs, but among the songs were these Burl Ives songs. And I came to realize that it was a kind of thing called folk song. And I, as a teenager, I learned how to play the guitar with chords, and so I fancied myself a bit of a folk singer. And by the time I was a senior in high school, I was actually, I performed at a high school thing. And so I could sing the fox, and I could do things like that. So when I guess it was about that time when I became aware that the Sorrell's family lived up the street, Rosalie and Jim and their children. And so just by a very amazing coincidence, we were two doors down from the epicenter of the energy for this movement that happened. And Rosalie was wonderfully, she was my mentor, or I don't know what the right term would be, but she helped me realize that I could do this kind of work. She used to, if she had a call for somebody to come, if somebody wanted her to come give a concert and she didn't have time for it or something like that, she would call me. I was one of the people that she had a little stable of people that she would call, and I was one of them. And so I got an opportunity to be on television for the first time because of that, and I learned how to perform in a more or less professional manner under various conditions, and it was through her that that became possible. I thought seriously about being a folk performer, but I guess about the late 60s, early 70s, that was when I sort of had to cross the Rubicon. It was going to be one or the other, and I thought about the very difficult life of a female folk singer particularly, and I thought, well, all things considered, maybe graduate school is a better choice. And so I stopped thinking about being a professional. But, Rosalie made a professional life in folk singing. I was just participating in the first big concert in 1961, and I was the editor of the newsletter of the Intermountain Folk Music Society, which was founded as a way of fostering activities here in the Valley. And I just remember the tremendous excitement. I will say also that I was a member of a group called Polly and the Valley Boys, which consisted of myself and Bruce Phillips, or Utah Phillips, and Dave Roylands. And the way that came about was that Bruce and Dave had been in a group called the Utah Valley Boys, spelled B-O-Y apostrophe S on their card. And they had been together for two or three years. There were various changes in personnel, but they had gone finally to the Galax Folk Festival in Galax, Virginia in the summer of 64. And it was a long and arduous journey. And by the time they returned, the schisms within the group were so complete that two of them sort of sneaked off in the middle of the night and joined up with another bunch and formed a new group. And Bruce and Dave were sort of left out in the cold, sort of scratching their heads. And so they asked me if I would join them, and we became Polly and the Valley Boys. And this was before there was such a thing as Valley Girls, and so it did not have that connotation. And I was an honorary boy, that's right, yeah. So we had about a year and a half or 2 years of doing some singing out, and so I had that experience as well. I learned a lot of Bruce Phillips's songs, and we did other songs as well, and we were an old-time string band. So that's my history in Salt Lake Valley on the folk music scene ends in 1966 when I left to go to graduate school. So that's really what I have to say at this point about sort of how I did it and what happened and all that kind of thing. And I'd like to just turn the stage over to Barry.
Me?
Barry Topin.